morning, guys. So, you know, sometimes it's not that easy standing up here for various of reasons. I was sitting there thinking, can't we just watch an alpha movie this morning? But part of it is because I was farming the whole of last night. You wouldn't believe. Eh? Farming. So I spent some time working on the sermon, and then I spent some time in prayer, and when I went to bed, the presence of God was just so good. I struggled to fall asleep, and then eventually when I fell asleep, my wife bought a farm, and I spent the rest of the evening farming, and it was lovely. But I got up this morning thinking, my dear, was it necessary to buy a farm? So, one day, I'd like to ask God, dreams, how do they work? We've been talking about kindness this month. And my theme for this morning is the value of kindness. The value of kindness. You know, kindness is it's one of those fruits of the Spirit, one of those character traits which today in the world that we live in is very much undervalued. We sort of, it's like those that shirt that you only put on a Sunday and you hide it in the cupboard. Especially Monday to Saturday, it's put far away because there's other stuff that's more important than being kind. And then every once in a while on a Sunday or a special occasion, I need to go and fetch that shirt and I need to put it on and I need to smile and I need to be kind. Eh? Isn't that true? And this rush of life. And we forget that we are called to be kind. So this morning, we're looking at kindness. Are you kind? Are you kind? Yes? Are you consistently kind? Sorry? No? Yes? See, we're called to be consistently kind without these blips in between, like an ECG, you know? It's got those blips. So if we hit that straight line of kindness consistently, it means that the old man has died. The new one that's risen with Christ, we have the ability to be kind. When there's a lot of these blips, it means the old man is still alive and kicking. The flesh is still there and we're struggling. But we all would like to be called kind. We all want to be able to express kindness. All of us, I'm sure. All of us. So if we would like to be associated with kindness, where does it come from? How do we access it? How do we get it? Where does it come from? Can it be purchased? Can I buy kindness? Not. Imagine, $10 for a week's supply of kindness. Wouldn't that be something? I can see those adverts. Take one tablet of kindness every day and be a blessing in every way. That boss's office on his birthday, it's just filled with kindness hampers, making sure there's enough kindness to last the whole year. If only it were that easy. And not that it's that difficult. It's not that difficult to be kind. So I thought this morning, maybe we should just have a practical exercise of being kind. I can see some of you sitting there thinking, So here's what I want us to do. And it's not difficult. You can do it right where you're seated. Or you can get up and you can walk towards someone as the Holy Spirit leads you. What I want you to do is you look them in the eye, preferably if it's husband and wife, into your wife and your husband's eyes. You look at them and you tell them that you appreciate, you are thankful, and you appreciate them being part of this body. And that you value their unique personality and gifting and purpose which God has placed upon them. And then you remind them of Ephesians 2, which says that they are God's workmanship, created in Jesus Christ for good works, which God has prepared in advance. Can we do that? Can we do that? Let's do that. Okay. It seems like it's a lot of fun being kind. So I would like to call all of you back to your chairs now. You are saying more than what I gave you. So I'm not sure what you're saying. So guys, it's easy. It's actually easy. And it's a blessing. It's a blessing to be able to be kind. And you know what? When we spoke those words, it's God's words. Ephesians 2:10. It's God's words. We're proclaiming His promises that stand. Prophesying over someone's life. It is beautiful. So being kind is not that difficult. But mostly it is easy where I choose to be kind. That's easy. But in other situations, it is almost like a bad day on Mount Everest, impossible being kind in certain situations where God expects of me to be kind. You see, when I've been hurt and stepped on and falsely accused and I've been criticized and it hurts and God says, be kind. Those are those moments where it really matters, but it's difficult. It's really difficult. And Volker said something this week which really struck with me. He said he heard someone speak about it, that when we stand in front of God one day, we will only stand there to give account. We will only stand there to give account. There is no excuse. Not the best excuse in the world will be able to stand in the presence of God. No excuse. And if it's true for then, it is true for now. Because I'm standing in God's presence already. I know it will be different, but I'm already before God. Think about it. No excuse. Because it's easy for us. We come up with excuses like this. If I've been hurt, no, I can't be kind. God, why do I need to forgive? But He has been there. He knows our emotions. There is no excuse. We have no excuse. We are already ambassadors. We're already citizens in His kingdom. Ephesians 4 verse 32 says, be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Read it again. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ Jesus forgave you. When I read this and I got to that portion which said tender-hearted, I remembered 6-7 years ago at a church planters course, the guy spoke about ministry and he wanted to make sure that we wanted to be in ministry, because he said, listen, it's difficult. You need to have a thick skin and a soft heart continuously. But it's true for everyone. Soft-hearted, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. See, kindness and forgiveness is linked very closely together. They go together. They go together. And when we're holding on to grudges, offense, having arguments in our heads with people, it is clear warning signs that something is wrong. It's that red light flashing. It's the Holy Spirit saying, hey, stop. Something is wrong. Just stop. We need to stop in that moment. We're busy having arguments with people in our heads. Stop. Spend time with God. God, what is this? Because if I continue down this way, I'm going to end up crashing. It's going to hurt me, and it's going to hurt other people. I need to stop and say, God, what do you say about this? And the thing is, forgiveness is not an option. for us as Christians. It's a command. We don't have an option. It is a command. Have to forgive. God is in the business of healing and restoring the hurt and the broken. So if I make a choice to forgive, God will give me the strength. He will give me the wisdom. He will give me the words. But the choice is with me. The choice is with me. God waits for me so that I can make that choice to forgive. And then he comes alongside us and he enables us to be able to restore that relationship, to continue down with this journey. He enables us. And we heard a beautiful testimony on Tuesday evening about kindness and forgiveness. And it's something that God is continuously doing, assisting us with. But we need to make that choice. So kindness, as we said, is both very easy and simple. And at the same time, it's difficult, nearly impossible, in certain situations, without God. And the emphasis here is, without God, it will be impossible. You know, there are many kind people out there in the world, many kind people, who choose to be kind where they want to be kind. And they help, and they give money, and they love, and they become a voice for the voiceless, and they do many things. And many of those things with a hidden agenda of love all, accept all, help all, because all roads lead to heaven. All roads lead to God. Do you believe that? Not. We need to be aware of that, because a lot of that is going on in our world today. And if we agree to this, that not all roads lead to God, we agree that the truth is that it's only through Jesus Christ that we are united with God. Only through him. John 14:6. He is the way, the truth, and the life. There is no other way. No other truth. If we believe that, we also believe that Scripture is true, that through the Holy Spirit, we have Jesus with us. I have Jesus with me. And if that's true, my kindness is supposed to be Christ-like kindness. And that's supposed to distinguish us from the rest. Christ-like kindness is different than other kindness. There's something else about it. And please hear me. I'm not saying we should be in competition with others trying to be kind. We need more people desperately wanting to be kind to others. It's not a competition. Jesus crushed that spirit of performance on the cross when he died for us. It's not a performance thing. It's not a show we put up. It's something authentic that happens because I have the Holy Spirit within me and I'm becoming Christ-like in my kindness. Kindness is not a show we put up, it's not a performance. But if we have Jesus now abiding in us and through the Holy Spirit, we should be able to show kindness where normally it's impossible. But because of him, we are enabled to do it. Kindness is not about what I can get out of it. It's not about receiving any glory for being kind. Kindness is all about Jesus. The fruit of the Spirit is there to make Jesus known to those out there in the world. When I have peace and joy and love and kindness and patience, it's supposed to point to Jesus. It's supposed to make Jesus known. That is the effect that it's supposed to have. The impact of Christ-like kindness should be distinguishable. Our kindness should reveal Jesus, make him known, lead people to fall more and more in love with him. So when we extend kindness, there should be this fragrance of Jesus that they experience. This fragrance of Jesus. And I don't know about you, but when you walk into a house and there's some lovely meal being cooked and you smell that amazing fragrance, it causes you to want to stay there and to want to have a look what's inside the pot and to eat of it. I want to partake of this. And when we extend kindness to people, Christ-like kindness, and they've got this fragrance of Jesus, It causes them to want to partake of him. The bread of life, the living waters. People are seeking, they are hungry, and they're unsure for what it is. And we call to be kind. Psalm 34 verse 8 says, taste and see that the Lord is good. So back to the initial question. If we all have a sincere desire to be kind to others, kind in a way Jesus was, looking at Jesus as the perfect example, how do we access it? And I'd like us to go to Galatians 5, verse 22 to 26. I know we've been there a couple of times already, but I'd like to go back. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. And Ed mentioned, and he said, how some of these actually fit together. I think he mentioned how kindness and goodness, it's just like they fit together. Gentleness and kindness. I can't be kind without being gentle. When I'm gentle with someone, there's kindness in it. You know, they just go together, but I look at them, and I see that it's with all of them. Love. Love seems to be the base from which all of them come out of. Self-control. How should I be kind if I don't have self-control? Patience. Without patience, I can't be kind. So they fit together, all of them. But where I want to go to is verse 24. It says, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. But just looking at verse 24 now, following these beautiful fruits that are mentioned, Paul points us back to the cross. Points us back to the cross, what took place on the cross. Why does he do that? And as Ed mentioned, when we read these fruits of the Spirit, it raises that bar so high. I mean, if we were to preach on each one of them, spend time, suddenly we become aware of what it actually means. And we look at it and we see, oh, Lord, how am I ever going to get there? We're so aware of our own faults and our own shortcomings. And we look at this and we say, what's the use? I can't do it. And it's true, we can't do it. And therefore, Paul points us back to the cross. Because something happened there. That old man died on the cross. He says we were crucified with him. So all these shortcomings, they were crucified with Christ. And it gives us hope again. And I realize, but it's been done. It spoke about that mirror. You know, it acts like a mirror. Suddenly we look in the mirror and we see where there's still spots. And it's true. It helps us to see where we're at. To take count where we're at. But God looks at us and he sees Christ because of what took place on the cross. It's amazing. It's been paid for. It was paid. Our debt was paid. The debt of sin was paid. But that payment did something else as well. It gave us access to things we should never have received. These fruits of the Spirit, including kindness, which I should never have been able to extend, God gave me access to because of Jesus dying on the cross for me. Yes, the workmanship of the cross. So firstly, how do we access it? I want to tell you, it's been paid for. The only thing is you didn't pay for it. Jesus did. So when I said, can it be purchased? You laughed at me. He purchased it for us. He paid for it. So your weekly, monthly, yearly, as long as you live, supply of kindness, it was paid for. It was paid for. You have received a kingdom receipt made out in your name. How's that? That's amazing. So if you're sitting here today, and you've never come to that place where you've acknowledged Jesus Christ as your Savior, what happens is if you come today and you repent of your sins and you turn to Jesus, and with your mouth you proclaim and with your heart you believe He as your Lord and Savior, the price that you paid 2,000 years ago gets processed in your name today, in that moment. Isn't that amazing? Guys, think about it. That is good news. That is good news. Have you ever had to pay for something quite expensive, only to get there, and someone paid it on your behalf? Has it happened to anyone? I take that feeling and times it with eternity. How do we do that? I don't know. But that's what it is. That feeling. I remember once I rode my mountain bike off, crashed it at a speed you would not believe. And God's grace was amazing. I survived it, but the bike was written off. And at that stage, I just met a young girl whom I liked a lot, and she was mountain biking. And I realized that if I couldn't go mountain biking with her, someone else was. So I put all my pennies together and went to see the guy at the cycling shop. And he ordered the bike, but it was a lot of money. And I didn't have, I actually needed it for other things, but I wanted that bike. So I was in this, almost this wrestle with God, because I kept feeling God said it's okay. But at the same time, I felt guilty. And the day before I had to do the payment came into my account. I got the SMS, and all it said was, mountain bike, paid for. That's amazing. And that feeling is what we should experience when you think about what God did for us through Jesus on the cross. And it's that feeling that's going to last for eternity. Our access to God's kindness is priceless. It is priceless. Romans 6, verses 4 to 5. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. That is amazing news. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Do you believe it? Do you actually believe it? Do you believe that God can be that type of goodness and kindness and love? Because that is the God we serve. I mean, we should never have been dealt with in this way. We deserved his wrath all the way. We should never have received what we received. Romans 2 verse 4 in the Amplified. I want to read it in the Amplified. Read with me and put your name there in the beginning. We say, Meiring, do you have no regard for the wealth of his kindness and tolerance? Those words, the wealth of his kindness and tolerance and patience in withholding his wrath. Meiring, are you actually unaware or are you ignorant? Do we claim ignorance of the fact that God's kindness leads us to repentance? What leads us to repentance? God's kindness leads us to repentance. That is to change the inner self, your old way of thinking, and seeking his purpose for your life now. That's beautiful. I love it. It's beautiful. See, if we struggle to grasp God's goodness, his kindness, his love, how am I going to be able to extend it to others? If I have not grasped it, if I have not made it mine, how do I extend it to anyone else? I can only imitate someone I have a relationship with. If you ask me to imitate my wife, I can do it. As some of you here, I'll be able to imitate. We have a relationship. If you ask me to imitate a person I do not know, I can't do it. I can only give from what I've received. So again, firstly, it was paid for by the King himself. Let's not make it cheap. It was a great price he paid. So kindness is a fruit of the Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, Christ-like kindness is impossible. And we will only serve our own agenda and desires. So verse 25, which says, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. So what it actually says is, it says that we can get out of step with the Spirit. It says that we can live in disobedience to the Holy Spirit. It says that we can live in such a way that I start lagging behind where the Holy Spirit is leading, because I get entangled in my own affairs, the things of the world, the fleshly desires and the passions. I get entangled in it, and now I'm struggling to hear the Holy Spirit. I'm struggling to act according to what He is leading me into. And on the other hand, sometimes we run ahead of God. We get so spiritually, we get so spiritual worked up and spiritually driven that we run ahead of God. We're journeying with God, and suddenly, there I go. God's like, where are you going? Come back. We're running, and we're doing. And it's all about that thing of doing. And we become so centered on the works of God that we completely neglect the God of the works. And suddenly it's not something out of relationship anymore, but it's this thing of doing. I have to be doing this now. It is for God. And we're running around and we're doing. But it's not in step with the Spirit. See, if I... Where was I now? Verse 25. See, there's a secret. And the thing is, the Holy Spirit never burdens us. He never places a yoke, a heavy yoke upon us. The yoke we receive is an easy yoke. It's not a heavy one. He never burdens us. He brings conviction, yes. But He doesn't place a yoke upon us that weighs us down. That's not Him. It's not Him. See, the law, which was initially meant to be God's good gift to His people, allowing them to live in obedience to Him, to have favor with Him, became this heavy yoke which just pressed them into the ground, which they couldn't carry anymore. Unbearable burden because of man's sinful nature. In contrast, Jesus, when He fulfilled the law by becoming the perfect sacrifice and payment for our sin, He made a way for us to enter into God's rest and His peace, to enter into a different way of doing things. His rest, His peace, to live, function, and have our being from that place. And it only comes through intimacy with Him, being in a relationship with Him. From a place of intimacy and relationship with Him, kindness and the other fruits of the Spirit will just become an extension of who He is. Matthew 11, 28 to 30 says, come to me, all you are weary and burdened, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. See, when you find yourself close to collapsing, close to burning out, frustrated beyond your senses, with not one inch left of capacity to be kind or patient, it's not God. That's not Him. It's not God. He doesn't lead us into those areas. He'll allow for it so that I can come to my senses, but He doesn't take us there. When we find ourselves in those places that where it feels like we're hitting these walls, it's one of two things. The one is it's the fallenness of the world. That we can't change. We are also exposed to it. If someone breaks into my house, it's what it is. It's part of this fallenness of the world. We will experience those troubles. The other one is it's through my own choices that I sometimes end up there. Not hearing from God. Running after my own things. Trying from my own strength. I find myself there. And God allows for us to go to that place where I hit my head. Because he desires for me to open up my eyes and see a new way of doing it. But the problem is, so many of us, we hit those walls. We fall flat on our faces. We get up. Once I get up, instead of taking Jesus' hand so that he can help me to journey through this wall, I just bounce back to where I was before, doing for God, having to perform for him. And it's not what he calls us for. Jesus said, his burden is light, his yoke is easy. Jesus never takes us on a sprint. He invites us on a journey. When we're busy sprinting, our lungs burning, and our legs can barely hold up, it's not him. 3 weeks ago, I attended something, and the person was speaking on this thing that there's always consistently an invitation that Jesus extends to us. In every season of our life, there's an invitation that he extends to me. And those invitations, because we are unique, looks different from one person to the other. They're all different. The one might be him extending an invitation to me of shaping. It's like the potter with the clay, a season of shaping. He says, I want to shape in you something. I want to grow you. Come with me. It might be an invitation of healing. I want to bring healing. Restoration. I want to bring restoration to your life. It might be a season where Jesus invites us to learn how to serve with him. Washing feet. But again, it's not something I'm going to do. He does it, and now he's going to teach me how. I'm going to do it with him. It's not me. And then they asked us, they said, so identify the invitation that's been handed to you. Man, and suddenly I struggled. Because I was running at that time, just a lot of stuff going on, and so much. And I said, God, help me. Because now I think back at the year and some of the things going on. I'm busy studying. I say, God, is it an invitation for learning more about you? Lord, is it an invitation to step out on the water as a scripture you gave him in the beginning of the year? What is this invitation? And in an instant, God is so faithful. I saw this picture in clarity where I'm running next to a beautiful mountain on a jeep track. And I see myself from a third-person point of view. I can see myself running, and I can see I'm running past someone. And the moment I saw that someone, I knew this is Jesus. But I'm running past him. Where I'm running to, I don't know. And then I see him calling me back. And as I turn around, he extends his hand to me, and he asks me to walk with him. Walk with me. Journey with me. And sometimes we just need to stop. And take a breath. Say, God, what is it that you're saying? And for me, it is now to be faithful in this. To say, Lord, show me the new way. And I'll ask you today, what is it that he is inviting you into? There's an invitation of kindness extended to you today. He's inviting you into something in this specific season of your life. And the question is, what is your reaction to it? He puts out the invitation. We need to react. John 15, verse 5. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Apart from me, your works, your doing is empty. It's going to get yourself in trouble. But if you remain in me, you will bear much fruit. It's an invitation into a relationship. Not into doing. Out of this relationship will flow the works. Those works he has prepared in advance for us. That comes from that relationship. Verse 6, if you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire and burned. Verse 7, if you remain in me, and my words remain in you. Ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Firstly, it was remain in me. Now it's if my words remain in you. There's like a sign here. If your words remain, my words remain in your heart, and that's what comes out of you, it's a sign that you are remaining in me. That's one of those things, if your words remain in me. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. That will be the evidence that we are his disciples, when his words remain in us. John 15, 9 to 10. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. The next one. It was remain in me. Allow my words to remain in you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept the Father's command and remained in his love. See, if we neglect the relationship, we will struggle with the commands. Without the relationship, we will struggle with what we have to do. Verse 11 says, I've told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. There's the command. Love each other as I have loved you. Be kind to each other as I have been kind to you. It comes out of a relationship with him. When we remain in him, we will be able to extend that love, to extend that kindness. It will be the evidence that we are in this relationship. It is not a qualification to be his disciple, but it's the evidence of us being his disciple. Verse 13, greater love has no one than this, to lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends. If you do what I command, I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I've called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. See, friends do not have secrets. Friends do not have secrets. And he says, I have not kept anything back from you. I have declared to you everything, because you're my friend. You're not just my servant. I've given you insight into my business. Why are we doing things? We're doing it the way we're doing. What the end is going to look like. It's going to be glorious. It's going to be victorious. I've given it to you because you're my friend. Verse 16, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command. Love each other. Again, this is his command. Love each other. Be kind to one another. Have patience with one another. It's his command. I'm only able to fulfill his commands if I stand in that relationship. If I am in step with the Holy Spirit, if I remain in him, the message speaks about making our house with him, making our house in him. That's beautiful. So we are at the end now. And I just like to say that kindness is rooted in love. Kindness is an expression of love. It's a selfless love. So this kindness is a selfless kindness. It's not wanting anything in return. It's being kind because I've received kindness from God. I've received love from him. And I cannot keep it with myself. I have to extend it. It's just an overflow. So to summarize, how do we access Christ-like kindness? First thing is, it's been paid for. You need to know it's been paid for. He's done it. He's given us access. Let's shake off the old. Let's walk in the new. The second thing is, it is in step with the Spirit, abiding in him, making our house with him, in him, that will enable us to extend Christ-like kindness. And lastly, kindness is the best offensive and defensive weapon we can have. It disarms the enemy. And I just want to end off with a short story of a minute or two. Last week, I heard it over Channel 7. The guy was telling about a pastor who ministered at a church. And before, I think it's before he started ministering, the ushers came and they said, they encountered two guys at the back who came in and they said they don't belong to a church and they don't want a church. They're just here to curse him, the preacher, because they're Satan's worshippers. And they've come to disrupt that service, to curse him and his family, the pastor did what any good pastor does. He went to them to inquire about this. And they said, yes, that's why we're here. And knowing his scripture, he said, but scripture says that he who is within me is greater than he who is in the world. So there's nothing you can do. And they said, but prove it. Prove it. If you believe it, prove it. That who is within you is greater than he that is in us. What would you do? I can think some pastors would then drive our demons, start praying in tongues, or look for that back door. And as he stood there, they kept this thing up, challenging him. But as he stood there, the Holy Spirit pointed to one of the two, and he said, walk over to that guy and give him a hug and hold him. And this you need discernment for. If you do it without the Holy Spirit, you'll get a mighty slap. But he did it. He stepped forward in faith, what the Holy Spirit showed him. And he grabbed that guy and he held him in a bear-like hug. And he said, I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. Because my Father in heaven loves you. And he loves you. And he loves you so much that he gave his son to hang on that cross for you, just as you are here. And his son, Jesus, much like you, walked this earth, but he was perfect, hanging on that cross, went through with it because he knew about today. He knew that you were going to stand here just as you are, with what everything that you've brought. And he wanted to tell you that he did it because he loves you. See, that's a kindness that disarms. And if we allow God's kindness and forgiveness to flow through us, we can end wars that have raged for years. Let's stand. I thank you, Lord, that this morning, God, we stand before you, Lord, and we acknowledge that without you, our works are empty, Lord. Without you, we will not achieve anything, Lord. We acknowledge, Lord, that it's all about you. And we desire, Lord, if we have in any way stepped out of rhythm with you, Holy Spirit, this morning we desire to step back into rhythm with you. Thank you that your yoke is light and your yoke is easy and your burden is light, Lord, that we don't need to carry heavy. Lord, help us to let go of things. Lord, help us to enjoy your love, your kindness, your goodness, Lord. Lord, to partake in it, Lord. To embrace it, Lord. Lord, and help us to be an open channel through which it can just flow, Lord. That we will not keep anything for ourselves, but it will just flow, Lord. It will flow to those around us, Lord. We love you, Lord Jesus. We ask, come and have your way in our lives. Amen. So thank you, guys. There's coffee and tea at the back. Please go and enjoy some coffee and tea. And I want to, before everyone leaves, I just want to say, when I said if there's anyone who has not responded ever to Jesus, that amazing transaction, I would just encourage you to please come and just see us at the front. We'd just love to pray with you. Amen. Have a blessed day.